I just want a chance to see her face.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the 1990 St. Louis County Cab Annual Drivers Meeting and Award Presentation. We really do have a good evening in store for you tonight. To begin with, we have our own award-winning driver. We have our own award-winning driver, Mr. Art Muller, who will demonstrate his life-saving CPR procedure with his mannequin Steve. And we have, we're lucky to have, again, from the Safety Council of Greater St. Louis, our old friend and safety expert, Mr. Bill Nelson. The Gregersons are all here tonight, and they have some very important announcements to make and a lot of awards to give out, so it should be an interesting evening. Our theme for this year's program is County Cab, where safety comes first. Let us all tonight reaffirm and recommit our dedication to safety. Let us all endeavor and vow to make County Cab in all the years to come the safest form of transportation in the St. Louis area. Then we will make our slogan and our theme an actual truism. St. Louis County Cab, where safety comes first. Most of us know our next speaker, Art Muller, is credited with saving the life of his passenger in October of 1988 and was subsequently honored with an award from not only our company, but from the Safety Council of Greater St. Louis and the International Taxi Cab Association. Art has also inspired our cab company to initiate a Red Cross certified CPR and standard first aid course, which is presently being offered to all our drivers and company employees. We're all very proud of Art, and tonight he's going to explain this course, and he's going to demonstrate how he teaches this CPR procedure. Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor to present Mr. Arthur I. Muller.
You all, when you came in and filled out your registration forms, you noticed a little couple boxes, yes or no, you would be interested in learning more about CPR. The results aren't too promising looking at those cards, but I'd like to take this opportunity to change lots of minds. I think the biggest, at least from what I hear from drivers, I think the biggest problem other than the time it takes to take the course is a lot of you honestly have fears about AIDS, about you actually feel you're going to be having bodily contact with somebody else. This is absolutely, totally, completely not true. As I'm going to show you with this mannequin here, as far as getting AIDS or something like this, it's absolutely impossible to get any kind of transmitted diseases from these mannequins. It's just not going to happen. You can't get AIDS anyway from saliva, so you know, it's just not going to happen. It's absolutely impossible. What I'd like to show you is how we do the CPR again, and there's no bodily contact, and I'll show you the mannequin right now. This is the mannequin that we use. He's called Chris Clean, and the 20 or 21 people that have gone through the course will tell you that it's a really great way to learn CPR, and the reason there is no fluid contact, no bodily contact at all, is they've come up with an ingenious way of doing the CPR. This is a plastic piece of plastic that's actually the lung. When you actually fold it up, roll it up, put it inside this hole here, and if everybody can see, I hope. Anyway, basically you put this plastic inside the mouthpiece here, and then you have your own individual mask, which is this right here, which you snap into the plastic, and you do all of your CPR into your very own mask and your very own lung. When you're done doing CPR, you take your lung out, take your mask off, and then we have a procedure to sanitize the face before the next person does anything. So it's only your own fluid that you're working with, not anybody else's. And it's a really great way to do it. I don't want to go into the whole procedure of doing the CPR. I hope you'll take the course for that. But I did want to show you to allay any fears that you're going to be, as some drivers have said, kissing somebody in this course. That's absolutely, totally false. Okay, are there any questions about this so far? Okay. This course takes 8 hours. It's Red Cross regulations, which I have to go by being a Red Cross instructor, and the company also has to go by because they have to sign a contract of sorts with the Red Cross. So it either has to be done in 1 8-hour session or 2 4-hour sessions. This makes no difference to me or the cab company, whichever way. If somebody wants to take a course for the 8 hours or the 2 4-hours, if we get enough people for either one, I'm glad to conduct the course almost any time. So the 8-hour courses we have done have been mostly on Sundays, and they worked out real well. And we've had a couple 4-hour sessions on a Monday and Tuesday or something like that in the evening. Those have also worked out well. So what I'm trying to say is I'm willing to work with anybody here. If you want to take it a particular time, it doesn't matter to me. The only problem is the Red Cross requires a minimum number and a maximum number per class. And the company pays $15 per student to take the course. County Cab is paying all of the fees for it, and it has to be paid in advance of the class. So if 6 people sign up and only 3 show up, it doesn't look real good, and it's also costing the company some money. Can I see a show of hands of anybody who might possibly, in the near future, be interested in an 8-hour class? Okay. And those that might be interested in 2 4-hour classes. Okay, that's not a great number, but it's a start. If you will see either Bob Lopez or myself, either at the end of the meeting or sometime at the cab company. I drive cab 93. If anybody sees me around and wants to talk to me about it, please feel free to. And finally, the way I feel about it and the company feels about it, 8 hours is a small amount of time to take, to learn, have the knowledge to save somebody's life. It could be your kid, your mother, your father, anybody. So it's not anything to be taken lightly as far as I'm concerned. Any questions, comments? Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Art. With your kind indulgence, we'd like to take a moment from our activities tonight to remember and meditate on our drivers that have left us this last year. We're going to miss these guys a lot, but I'm reminded of an epitaph I once read on a tombstone, which says, "He who lives in the hearts of those he leaves behind shall never die." Veteran driver and everyone's friend, Mr. John L. Crawford. Longtime driver and dispatcher, Mr. Robert W. Leonard. He was too young to die, and we're all going to miss Mr. Jesse A. Wallace. And now I have the honor once again to introduce a man that has helped us tremendously in the last 3 and 4 years. He's a director of the Highway Safety Training Programs for the Greater St. Louis Safety Council, and he's agreed to come back to us tonight. I'm sure he'd rather be home. He's got a new baby, another new baby. He has two boys now, and I'm sure he's anxious to get home. But he's consented to, generously consented to come down here tonight. I've introduced him with poetry. I introduced him with all kinds of compliments, and it embarrasses him a little bit. So I'm not going to do that tonight. I just want to explain that before County Cab came under the influence of the St. Louis, Greater St. Louis Safety Council, the first year we came under their influence, we reduced chargeable accidents at St. Louis County Cab by 40%. This year, we reduced chargeable accidents compared to last year, 19%, which really could use some improvement. But our reduction in chargeable accidents this year that has just ended, compared with the time before the safety program and the safety council, they've been reduced 37%. But the main point of that is that it's not just St. Louis County Cab that Bill Nelson works with. You ought to see their clientele list. It reads like a who's who in industry and commerce. Monsanto Chemical, Washington University, the Ferguson and Florissant school districts, Gray Eagle Distributing. So many big companies that could go on and on. But what I'm trying to get at is he's not only helping us, but he's helping all these other companies too. So it's really a great honor to present the director of the Highway Safety Training Programs for the Safety Council of Greater St. Louis, our friend, Mr. Bill Nelson.
I got Bill.
You always do that.
Nice to see you. Use the mic. Can you guys hear me now? Oh, I got to stick it in my mouth to talk to you. Okay, now, when Bob was introducing me, Bob always embarrasses me when he does that. But he mentioned that I had just had another baby. And he's a little wrong with that. My wife just had another baby, and I helped a little bit. Okay? Secondly, he also mentioned that I was in a hurry to get back home to the two kids. I have to get back home because if I don't get back home soon, my wife is going to get me. And some of you guys know how that is. But we just had a new baby who's 6 weeks old. So if anybody has any milk, new or used Pampers, we'll take those too. Diapers, T-shirts, we'll take it all. But the reason Bob asked me to come out tonight is because he knows that the Safety Council is involved in driver's training programs. And we're also involved in court-referred programs, and we're also involved in alcohol programs. But one of the things that I want to mention is that I think you guys have done a fantastic job over the last 2 years. I think it's 3 years now since the program was implemented. The accident rate has come down. I've always looked at St. Louis County Cab as one of the premier cab companies in this area. When I see one of you guys driving in St. Louis City or St. Louis County, you look good. Your vehicle looks good. You look good. You're well-mannered. And that means an awful lot to a company. When I drive up and down the highways of this area, I look at the vehicles that are driving around me, and some of them are just like yours. They're driving billboards with the name of that company on the side. And every time you do something good, that's a reflection on that company, just as every time you do something in a negative manner, that's a reflection on that company. So you guys should be aware of that each and every time you climb inside that vehicle. I know that the winter months are coming on us. It's going to be cold outside. When I was talking to Bob yesterday, he asked me to mention a couple of things for you guys to look for during the winter months when you're driving. And one of the things you should look for when you're driving on overpasses or bridges, you want to look out because they freeze up a little faster than other areas. During the winter months when you're driving in shaded areas, you want to be on the lookout because the roads freeze up a little faster. You might end up hydroplaning. And I'm sure that everyone in here knows what the term hydroplane means. And it basically means that you're going to go into a slid, and you're going to slide. And I'm quite sure that everyone in here knows that once you go into a slide, there's not an awful lot you can do about it except try and maintain the vehicle and steer in the direction you want to go. Years ago, we were taught that if your vehicle goes into a slide, you should steer in the direction of the slide. Things have changed since that time. You should steer in the direction that you want the vehicle to go so that once you come out of the slide, you are going in the direction that you initially wanted the vehicle to go. But a lot of us have a tendency to oversteer once the vehicle goes into a slide. So maintain control of the automobile and steer in the direction you want the vehicle to go. Bob also mentioned that there had been some minor problems regarding following distance. So he wanted me to emphasize that. Last year, I think 2 years ago when I was here, we mentioned something briefly about a 2-second rule. And a 2-second rule basically means to leave 2 seconds between your vehicle and the vehicle that you're following. And I'm sure that we're all familiar with that. Basically means we must maintain adequate following distance when we're driving on the roadways. There's not an awful lot for me to say to you guys. You guys drive out there every day. You see some of the mistakes that people make each and every day as you on the roadway. You see some of the dumb things that we do as drivers. But I got a question for you guys right now. How many folks in this room have been driving a cab for over 5 years? Give me some hands. How many of the folks in this room have been accident-free for over 5 years? You guys are doing an excellent job, and I hope you're able to continue to do that. I want to leave you guys a few minutes from now. I want to thank you and Bob and Mr. G for having me come out this evening. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Mr. G, I understand you haven't been feeling well.
And now I have been given the honor of introducing St. Louis County Cab Company's Chairman of the Board and the Chief Executive Officer, Mr. G. But really, I'd rather introduce Mr. G as our friend, because I've seen so many examples of his friendship. I just want to tell you one little story in regard to this, and that's about an old driver we had named Ray Larish. Ray had a friend that moved to New York with a horse stable. And one day he got a call from this friend who said that his stable was sending a horse to St. Louis for a race, and that this horse could beat anything at Fairmount Park or Cahokia Downs. Unfortunately, Ray was busted, and he couldn't cash in on this great tip. So who did he go to? He went to Mr. G. Now, Mr. G doesn't like horse racing. For whatever reason, moral or otherwise, Mr. G just does not like horse racing. So what happened when Ray told him his sad story? Well, Mr. G loaned him the money to supposedly cash in on this hot tip. The horse lost in a photo finish. But that's not the point of my story. The point is that Mr. G went against his principles, his ethics, to help a friend, to be a friend. And this is just one of the many countless times that Mr. G has shown his friendship over and over again. That is why tonight, instead of introducing him as a great leader, a great businessman, and a great cabman that he is, I'd like to introduce him as our great friend, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Thomas M. Gregerson.
Can you hear me? How about now? Okay. All right, before I get on with a few things that I have to bring up this evening, I'd like to call on my son, Tom, to make a presentation. Tom?
Now, I know you can hear me. Yeah, I do have a presentation to make. It's kind of important, I think. If we could have Mr. Nelson return for a presentation. It's not milk and it's not Pampers, though. Bill, we've got a plaque for you that you've done so much for us. I'd like to read it. It says St. Louis County Cab Company Incorporated, special award presented to William Nelson in recognition of his valuable contribution to the safety program of St. Louis County Cab Company Incorporated, 1987, 88, 89, and 90. And Bill, we do appreciate it. Thank you. I know you didn't. Now you can go home to that baby. And Bill has. He's really been a great help, as you all know. Now let Dad do his thing. Well, just sit.
I believe I can sit just as easy. Now, can you hear me?
Pretty close.
I'm talking into it, I thought.
There you go.
Okay, all right. Okay, I'm not going to take my usual hour and a half time tonight. I do have a few things I'd like to bring up. One of them is, on October the 1st, we went into wearing ties and jackets. And believe me, fellas, from what little bit I can see, yous look great. So I ask you to keep it up. And like Bill said a while ago, he sees our cabs going down the street. We're a rolling billboard. The cabs look nice. The drivers are nice. They're polite. And it means so much to us because that's all we have to sell is ourself and service. Now, the main thing that I would like to bring up tonight is the price of gasoline, and where it's going, we don't know. I've talked to several of you in the past 8 or 10 days, and some of the drivers have felt that we need a rate increase. Had others that feels no, we do not need a rate increase. So I would like to tell you what we have done. We have checked out with the meter shop how soon we could get our meters changed. We've checked out with the decals how soon we could get our decals changed. And if we have a rate increase, it would not be before December the 1st that we could implement everything and get it done. Now, I'm not firmly convinced that we need a rate increase. But on the other hand, everything is going so high, and maybe this is the time coming into the winter that we need a rate increase. Now, I'm just going to ask one question. I'm going to ask two questions. One, giving it a lot of consideration, what it will mean to us as a company and to you personally. How many would like to keep the rate as it is? I think that answers me. I said, how many would like to keep the rate as it is? How many?
How many want to leave it the same? Yeah.
Okay. How many would like to, well, how many feel that we really need a rate increase? I can't see them, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, but Tom says that they're considerably more. But we don't fear other cab companies. We went ahead and raised, let me have your attention, please.
Closer,
I can wait.
There you go.
Okay. I said, we don't fear other cab companies. We don't care if they go up or don't go up. If we need the increase, we need to support ourselves, to support all the things that we do, why, then a rate increase it will be. And what we will do is that we'll probably get a group, maybe about 10 men, picked out from owners, picked out from single shift drivers, and from shift drivers, and then sit down with them and see where we establish the rate. I know you have to go a dime a mile, but do we raise the flagpole? Off the top of my head, I would say no. We leave it right where it is at $1.45. But do we go for the extra passenger to raise it higher or lower? Yeah. And I would be myself inclined to think that we should leave it the same and not go or lower and not go to the higher dollar, because we're not downtown in the convention area that the other cab companies are that went to a dollar. And we have had some comments from people saying that they hope that we didn't go up, or they didn't know why that we had to charge extra passengers anyway, because it took the same amount of gas to get them there, you know. So we will be checking this out in a very few days and get the thing rolling, and probably come up with a rate increase by December the 1st. Now, will it be a proration increase? The answer was no if there's no rate increase. The answer will be yes if there is a rate increase. The answer may have been yes in the future if there was no increase, if we cause it from accidents or so forth. But we have had, we've raised our dispatchers, we've raised our office personnel, the operators upstairs, we've raised them all up to, we think, what is a good livable wage, and we're proud to say that we're getting better order takers and dispatchers. I'm sure that we are. And our increase keeps going up in the parts of automobiles and paint job, putting in a new car, anything that we do, it keeps going up. So if we have a rate increase and we have a pro increase or a rental increase, I'm sure, as we have always done in the past, that it will be what we figure. Our increase keeps going up in the parts of automobiles and paint job, putting in a new car, anything that we do, it keeps going up. So if we have a rate increase and we have a pro increase or a rental increase, I'm sure, as we have always done in the past, that it will be what we figure that we need, and it has always been, I would say, a minimal increase according to the benefits that it should give you on the street. Now, that's about all that I have to say for now, and I'm going to turn it over to Ron, son Ron.
Which one, Pete? Oh, yeah, that one. I don't have too much to say. Can you hear this or not? Which one are you talking to? This one? Good. It's just a dispatch, and I have to keep going over and over the same thing, but I'll try again. You know, we're having trouble filling some of the orders, the DSEG trips. I know the games that are played on them. Well, then come up a little closer. Or like you do in the street, lie about where you're sitting. No, I'm kidding. Maybe I'm not kidding.
You call it a dart?
Yeah, right. But we have the same problems over and over. I appeal to you to try to use a little more radio courtesy. People just, it's a hard job up there. It's a lot harder than you think. It's gotten more complex with the school sheets you have to use besides the regular trips. And I know the dispatchers are a pain in the ass too sometimes. There's no doubt about that. I'm not, but the rest of them are. And so try to bear with them. But on the other hand, if you don't know how it destroys you to be putting out orders and guys just bust in with stupid questions. Just worse than that, questions aren't bad. It's when you answer, you know, use a little common sense. When they answer four or five or six cabs on an X, don't come in 5 miles from the order terminating 5 miles away. It happens all day long. Clayton's X, and the guy says, I'm leaving the airport terminating the West Roads. Get the hell out of here. Happened yesterday, exactly that, what I just told you. Guy that's been here 10 years. That rating ain't gonna make 10 more years, I guarantee you that. But really, we just appeal. You gotta work together. I know there's some trips that are not your favorite. I know there's some trips that are, but you got to give service. We don't have one thing to sell except service. Whether you like a particular trip or I do, you know, they got it. They want a county cab. We got to give them a county cab. And you got to help them out. These guys go crazy trying to fill them orders. You just got to do it. You got to open doors. You got to, that's all we got to sell, really. I appeal to all of you. You got one thing to sell, and that's service and courtesy. You don't get a tip sitting on your ass. You don't deserve it. Get out and open the doors. A couple of things I will say, the dispatchers have been lax about when we put the new procedure in. We said that they would give you the school you were going to, and then you'd switch to three and they'd read you the information. I understand they're not doing that, a lot of them. They will do that starting tomorrow. Because I know it backs up, but at least you can be driving to the school or towards the order while you're waiting to get in on that channel. That's the basic thing I have in dispatching. I'll later field a few questions, maybe see how the meeting goes, how much time we got. So now I'd like to introduce my brother, Tom.
Y'all get the idea we're kind of hurrying this along or something? It's not really that way. It's just, you know, we know that you've got other things to do, but this meeting is important. I think it started off well. Mr. Nelson, I mean, he really has contributed, you know, and the accidents have improved. I mean, there's, y'all, both ladies and gentlemen, are doing a good job. You really are. It's getting better. That brings me to the point, I don't know how I got elected to do this, but I do have good news and I do have bad news. The good news is that this year we have 144 people eligible for the safety award. In other words, they went all year without having an accident. Now that's an increase. Last year we only had 124. So we are going in the right direction. And to the 144 people that are due to receive a reward, the bad news is the awards didn't get here. They're being shipped out of Massachusetts tomorrow morning. They'll be in the office. We'll have to call you all by and give your awards on an individual basis. A little bit later on, I will read those people that are entitled to the award. So I don't know if that's good news or bad news, that you don't have to watch everybody stand up here. And those that don't get them, I guess, don't have to be quite as embarrassed because they're still sitting. But hopefully next year, you'll all be up here getting an award. Just a couple of things listening to Dad and Ron. On the, excuse me, the rate situation, the one area that I'm mostly concerned with, and Dad was going to mention, we have petitioned, I guess is the word, the state of Missouri for a potential increase in the desegregation contract. Quite frankly, I think our chances are slim, very slim. It is an ironclad contract. When we bid it 3 years ago, we put a provision in there that an increase in case of a tremendous increase in expenses, which gasoline falls in that category, that we have the right to increase the rates. When the contract came back, that clause was stricken from it. We still feel that we have a real hardship case here. It is a, I feel, and I think most of you feel, it is a good contract. Now, it is run at a reduced rate, there's no doubt about it. But still, they spend over $1 million a year with us. You know, that pays a lot of rentals, prorations, feeds a lot of families. So it is a darn good contract. But we still feel that, you know, if we can get anything from it, if we get a nickel, it would be a help. I don't know what'll happen. We've already, you know, our attorney's been in contact with them. We've gone through the formalities, the paperwork, and whatever. Hopefully something will come of it. If it does, I mean, you know, I hope so. On the other part, you know, everybody has mixed feelings whether we should raise rates or shouldn't raise rates. I can sit down and make an argument on both sides of it. I know that when we do make a decision with this committee that Dad was talking about, we'll all feel that it's the right one, that's the best for everybody. For you all, certainly. And I think we have to consider our customers, too. Because, I mean, we've known, you know, it's statistically, anytime you increase your rates, you're going to lose some business. So you have to weigh that against everything that you do. And I think we'll really work on that. As far as everything else, the dispatchers, I don't know. You know, I mean, I know Mr. Hilton has a lot of trouble with some of the people that don't He doesn't feel that they cooperate with him as strongly as they should. But, you know, we're all in this together. I mean, a lot of you don't feel Mr. Hilton cooperates with you. But it is, you know, we're all one big family. And I think it's important that we all work together. It's the only way we're going to get better. I mean, we're already the best. There's no doubt about that. But we do have to stay together. And, you know, if you have to take a little air to help a dispatcher out, I mean, I think he'll return the favor someplace along the line in a legal manner, I hope. Bill Nelson's mentioned something that I know Dad's preached for years about taxi cabs being a billboard, and you really are. There's no doubt about it. Whether it's, and hopefully it's usually in a good manner. Now, one thing that when Art was up here talking about his program, which really I would encourage everybody to take this thing. It's it is a good course. You know, it's 8 hours out of your lifetime that you're devoting for the possibility to save one life. One suggestion I was going to make to Art, I'm not sure if it's a good one, but it might help. I know he was mentioning how they sanitize the mannequin. And I was thinking maybe if you spray it with Budweiser fumes, you might get a little better participation. But at this time... Johnny Walker? Okay, possibility. But at this time, I would like to at least read the names of those who are eligible for the safety awards and will be receiving them when they're shipped here. Correct, Bob? Okay. Now, all these people, both ladies and gentlemen, have driven a year without an accident, Charge Blackston, and that's a commendable thing. It really is. Many of them, as you'll notice, are repeats year after year after year. So I will read their names. I'll go rather quickly, and, you know, we don't have to clap and stomp for each one, but they really are deserving of your appreciation and certainly our appreciation in management. And they're somewhat alphabetical with a slight exception or two. Bill Adams, Hampton Adams, Merle Albright, Roy Allen, Tom Andrews, Ernie Avila, Ken Ayers, Robert Balch, Vern Barnhart, Al Sleepy Becton, sometimes known as Vince, Stan Bernstein, Bill Berry, Dennis Bose, Cicero T. Brady, Joe Breeding, Gordon Brewer, William Brower, James Bruton, Joe Burton, Walter Carey, Bob Carruthers, Gary Chenoweth, Dan Collier, Robert Cook, William Copeland, Mary Crawford, Jim Curia, Bob Daly, Faith W. Darr. Faith Darr, how about that? Congratulations, Faith.
Bill Darr,
that's right. Watt Davis, Tim Dodd, Ray Douglas, Floyd Eckhoff, Frank Eichmeyer, Paul Eisler, Boots Elman, Bob Engel, Irwin B. Fitter, Ray Fitzgerald, Richard Glassman, Frank Graves, Robert Green, Adam Greenlee, Ronald Thomas Gregerson, that's Ron's son. How come you're not on here, Ron? Ralph Guffey, Ed Haas, William Haggett, Larry Harper, Bob Haskin, Steve Hatcher, Ray Heath, Ted Hoffman. I'm getting winded. No. Ivan Doyle Hornbeck, John Hauser, Richard Hauser, Jay Holsketter, Norbert Human, Jim Hull, Larry Jenkins, Gary Johnson, Jack Jones, Rufus Kendall Jr., that's pretty good, father and son both, Richard Klump, Randy Lacey, Bob Lampson, Frank Larson, Stan Leffler, George Leonard, Frank Lazinski, Ralph Harpo Linder. That's my private name for Ralph. James Livingston, Norma Jean Luther, Chuck Manus, Melvin Manus, man, both of them, proud of them. Ed Marler, Joyce Mason, Jim McCabe, Tom McCarty, Larry McGinty, Ken McKinney, Lester McKinney, McKinney's are good, John McLaughlin, Frank Menendez, William Meyer, Carl Meissenek, Ken Miller, Ed Moore, Art Mueller, Henry Myers, Don Nickum, Peter E. Pepe Parisi, John Perdue. He liked that. Look at that. He's going to double. He's running it backwards. Look at that. No. John Perdue, Mark Pickett, Roland Pale, Bill Powers, Jim Price, Joe Riley, Robert E. Ed Denny Rice. Paula Peterson, Marvin Riley, Kim Roberts. I'm getting to the end slowly. Dennis Rohe. Actually, it's not slowly. I'm proud to be able to read this many names. Rodney K. Rowland, Otis Rummel, Charles L. Sanders, Larry Sandler, Richard Schlenk, Joe Snyder, George Schremeyer, Ed Sheeran, John Scott, Robert Scott, Charles Chuck Shepard, Walter Simmons, Jim Slattery, Richard Stevens, Cliff Story, Claude Stahl, William Thompson, Wayne Thurman, Ken Turner, Frank Utley, George Borey, Don Voss, Charles Wacker, Jess Wallace, who just did deserve it, Ron Ward, Claude Watson, Terry Wheat, Tom Wheat, Ken Williams, Ron Wolinski, Phil Works, that's Lee, Bennett Wright, William Wright, and Henry Zoltowski. I think they're all deserving of a big round of applause. Now I have another special award. I'm in charge of special awards this evening. I'd like to have, I don't want to read those, no. William E. Smith, I'd like you to come to the podium, please. I skipped Bill's name when I was reading the list because he's been on here so many times we don't even read it. But we certainly think he's entitled to a special award also. And it's the same way I'll read it to you. It's a special award is presented to William E. Smith in recognition of his 19 years of accident-free driving for St. Louis County taxi cab driver 1971 through 1990. I think it's quite an accomplishment. Ladies and gentlemen, that special part of the evening, we give away gasoline at Union Service. I hope you all signed up and filled out a card here. If you didn't, it's too late. You can't enter now. Entries are closed. Does that sound familiar? Can't enter again? No. What we're going to do is we're going to give away one $20 certificate and then three $15 certificates. And as we all know, that's not even a tank full of gas anymore. The premium, whatever you want, doesn't matter, whatever kind of gas it is. Ron, you going to do the honors? Now, Ron's drawing these names, remember that. $20 certificate goes to, my goodness, Willie T. Fimmer. Hey, Willie. Yeah, just keep that one separate. All right, $15 to go. Man, if he takes that long to sort the orders when he's dispatching, we're all in trouble. There's a gentleman who always used gas, Hampton Adams. I was looking at him earlier, I noticed there was one in there that had some gum stuck on it. Somebody was trying to get a little advantage, you know. Vern Barnhart. All right. two more 15s to go.
How many is that?
This is the third one. Oh, my. Easiest way just to say Gomer. Richard Connorsman. And last in this evening's drawing, which will also be another drawing tomorrow if you want to come back and get in her again, I guess. A ladies' special award. That's true. That's true. And last but not least, Ed Beck. Ed. That's four 15s and one 20.
Let's give an end.
What?
Another 20.
All right. Dad's in a good mood. One more 20, he says. Last chance. Okay. We just realized gas went up, so the prizes should go up, right? This is the $20 one. Ladies only. No. No, this is no lady. Not what is it, guys? Wayne Thurman. How many years in a row is that you've won, Wayne? Two in a row. Yeah. No. Sorry, that's all. Thank you.
Someone just asked a question here. How many drivers did we have that didn't have DSEG license? We have probably four or five that had DSEG license and now do not run DSEGs because they are over 71 years old. We have a few that have had problems. They're working out of them. We take no new applicants that have any previous DWIs. We don't take any applications on anybody that's got points that their license have been suspended within the last 5 years. So it isn't going to be long till it will just eliminate itself. And anybody that gets a DWI now, since we've been into this program, they're not eligible to drive a county cab anymore, if we know about it. I don't think that I have too much more to say. The main thing was to let you know that we are working on a rate increase. Like Son Tom said, we've been in touch with the state here locally. We just didn't get any help at all from Mr. Hammond. He said he didn't think it would do us any good, but go on to Jeff City, and that's what we're doing. And if it doesn't do any good, remember one thing. Those trips have supported us a lot, and they're going to help support a lot in the future. And we are obligated to them through the year of 91. One of the things you probably don't know is that sometimes when we're as much as, is it 30 minutes?
20 minutes.
When we're as much as 20 minutes late on an order, they call and they refuse to pay it, and that's in our contract. And we've eaten sometimes $500 and $600 worth a month, and we're not going to do it anymore. Now, I don't want to sound mad, but I just expect a lot of cooperation in anything that we do. You've been wonderful. Everybody has in cooperating, or mostly everybody has. And all that I can say now is that the food is ready. There's soda, there's coffee. So let's visit a little bit and get together, right? Thank you.